we recognize that God is moving the church out of the buildings and into the community. Our church, Peace Chapel, was built for this. In times like these, the world needs a courageous church. We are more than conquerors through Him who loved us. Our church is a community development church. We've long transitioned from being internally focused to being a church that is culturally relevant while remaining biblically sound. We don't operate based on fear, but we operate based on facts and on faith.
After all that I've been through, who on earth can I turn to? I look to you.
Hello, Peace Chapel family. Pastor DeAntoine here. I want to take a moment to respond to the president's announcement that the people of faith are now allowed to gather together for worship. Today marks the 100th day since we've lost the first American to the coronavirus. Since then, we've lost over 100,000 people in the United States, with over 1 million confirmed cases. And although we certainly appreciate the restriction on churches being lifted, we've made a decision to proceed with caution. We're learning a lot about this virus, but there's so much more that we don't know. And so myself, along with the leadership of this church, we'll be getting together to discuss a plan to reopen that will take into consideration confirmed data, as well as the population of our church. We have quite a few seniors in our church, and we wouldn't want to do anything to expose them to the potential dangers that are associated with this virus. With that being said, we will not be gathering together for worship in the month of June. In the meantime, we'll continue to use creative methods to meet the needs of those in our community and those within our congregation. I want to encourage you to continue to pray for our congregation. Ask God to give the leadership of this church wisdom and courage. And also want to encourage you to take advantage of the opportunities that we have for you and your family to grow and stay connected. We have two prayer calls that take place daily at 8 a.m. and 12 p.m. We have a digital Bible study that takes place every Tuesday at 1 p.m. We have life groups every Thursday. These are digital life groups. And we continue to serve food and produce to those in need Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays. We have our Sunday worship broadcast on Sundays at 10:15. And also want to encourage you to continue to support us financially. Thank you to those who continue to mail in your offerings and to those who support us digitally. I love you, Peace Chapel, and I can't wait to get back together to worshiping. But in the meantime, we're going to continue to use what we have to do what we can to advance God's kingdom. May our God continue to bless you and keep you.
Good morning, Peace Chapel. Welcome to this morning's broadcast. My name is Sean B. I am the host and creator of Worship Junkie Radio. Thank you so much to those who have already checked out the broadcast. If you haven't checked it out yet, you can check it out easily by going to www.worshipjunkieradio.com, as well as you can download an app. It's its very own app, bringing you 24 hours a day of praise, worship, love, and gospel music. Just go to your Android store or your iPhone app store, download the app today. Once again, Worship Junkie Radio, and I love it. I'm also the worship leader at this awesome church, Peace Chapel. If you a member, go ahead and hit the likes, hit the thumbs up, do something. But yo, I love this ministry. If you love this ministry like I love this ministry, spread the word. Make sure you stay locked in and make sure that you enjoy today's sermon from Pastor Fitz. I love you. I'm Sean B. Enjoy the service. Peace. It's Worship Junkie Radio. We got what you need. Oh.
When the war is won, we will be sure, we will be sure.
Good morning, Peace Chapel, and welcome back to another amazing Sunday service. For those out there who don't know, my name is Nate Harris, and I come up here every Sunday and I tell you guys about the amazing things that we got going on here at this amazing church. Now, I'm not gonna lie to you guys, I am not in the best spirits. Clearly, we've been locked down for 3 months now because of the coronavirus, but now we're dealing with this whole George Floyd situation and there's protests and our country is literally in flames now. For the past 3 weeks, I didn't have any questions for God while Pastor Fitz was going through the series, Where is God At? But right now, I have a lot of questions for God. So if this is you, it's okay to question God, but I recommend each and every one of you go back and go over those 3 sermons that Pastor Fitz gave to us, because there's a lot of information in there that's very, very pertinent to the situations that are going on right now in our country, and you definitely can benefit from them. So it's okay to go back and research and go over things over and over and over again to make sure that you're actually retaining that information and apply it to your life right now as we are in a crazy crisis. Amen? Amen. Now, if you're new with us today, you are in for a treat because we are starting a brand new series called Homebound. This series is to provide insight into God's will for the structure of a home. We are without a doubt living in unprecedented times with this whole COVID-19 situation. Now, we've been stuck at home for about 3 months now. Now, at first it was all fun and games. You got to be at home with your family members and friends more often. Parents got to spend more time with their kids. Marriages, they had to spend more time together. So it was all cool. But I bet now, being stuck at home for 3 months, they're probably getting on your nerves. If you're single, married, or in between, this series is for you. We'll be going over practical ways how to parent, how to prepare to parent, and things that relate to parenthood in general. So if you know anyone who's interested in this series or someone that this could actually help, please let them know to come on over and take a seat and listen to the broadcast. 2, we want to always make sure that we're celebrating your birthdays without you having to tell us. So this is what I need each and every one of you guys to do. I need you guys to text us your birthdays to info@peacechapel.church. Your birthday right now, info@peacechapel.church. We also would like to do birthday tributes on our online broadcast. So parents, if you would like to do a tribute for your child, please make sure you do that video tribute and send it 2 days in prior to the broadcast. For you, make sure it gets on that Sunday broadcast, you have to send it in 2 days prior to info@peacechapel.church. We want to celebrate you guys' birthday. We need your help. I love you guys so much, and I can't wait for you guys to hear this one. You're going to love it. But I will see you in there. Bye!
No one can win the war individually. It takes the wisdom of the elders and young people's energy. Welcome to the story we call victory. The coming of the Lord. My eyes have seen the glory.
One day, when the glory comes.
God, I look to you, and I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision to see things like you do. God, I look to you, and you're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom, 'cause you know just what to do. Forever all my days, I will love. God, God, I look. God, I look to you, and I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision to see things like you do. God, I look to you, and you're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom, 'cause you know just what to do. And I will love you, Lord, my strength. And I will love you, Lord, my shield. Yes, I will love you, Lord, my rock. Forever, all my days, I will love you, God. Sing hallelujah. Oh,
hello, Peace Chapel family and friends, those who are joining us online for the first time, welcome to Peace Chapel. My name is DeAntoine Fitz. I'm the senior pastor here at Peace Chapel in Los Angeles. As customary, what I like to do is give a shout out to a few people who have been engaged online. We want to let you know that we see you and we appreciate you being engaged. I want to give it up to Gracie Hines. Thank you for being a part of our church family. Thank you for being a part of our online community. Cavaniel Adams, thank you for rocking with us, Cavaniel Adams. We appreciate all the comments that you put in the comment section. Keisha Blue, that's the daughter of Deborah Baker. Thank you for being a part of our church family and being a part of our online community. I am extremely excited, Peace Chapel, because we're starting a brand new message series. For those of you who don't know what a message series is, that's one message that we take and we break it down into multiple parts so that we don't keep you long. I don't know if you guys noticed it, but we have been doing shorter messages because we want to encourage you to invite your friends to be a part of our online community, those people who are anxious and they don't like sitting around for a long time. You can let them know that we have very short messages here, but we want to make sure that we give you something real good. And that's what I'm excited about with this message series. We have something really good for you. The title of the message series is Homebound. And my thought is this, since we're going to be at home anyway, we need to make the most of our home. That your home should be a preparation ground, a preparation place to prepare your children for the future. And so this message is somewhat of a parenting series, but it's also like a life prep series and also a home prep series. This message is for parents, for single parents, for new parents, for parents of adult children, for grandchildren, for aspiring parents, those who want to be a parent, for those who are young adults and you want to have a better relationship with your parents, this message series is for you. Now, for me, I do have a little experience when it comes to parenting, but I have people in my church, people that I pastor, that are much more qualified to deliver this message than I am. People who I've watched do it right. People who I've watched do it wrong. people who have children who are adults and they're raising their own children. And so I don't consider myself to be the most qualified, but I do have a little context and experience because I've had some failure at parenting and I've been successful at parenting. I want to give you guys a little information about my children. I have 3 biological and I have 1 that I consider my own. My youngest is my baby girl, Maya. She's 21 years old. She's in college at Grand Canyon University. She's due to graduate this year. I'm extremely proud of her. She's a working college student. And then my next oldest is Malik. He's 23. He's at St. Mary's. He's getting ready to graduate as well. He's also declared for the draft. I'm extremely happy for him. He's put in a lot of work, and I believe that he's going to play basketball for money. And so kudos to Malik. And then my oldest is DeAntoine Jr. That's my first. We kind of grew up together. Not only is he my son, but he's also my friend. And he's actually training his brother and preparing him to enter into the draft. And so I'm excited about my children. Toya, she's probably the most responsible of all. She's a student and she's a parent. She's raising 2 young children and she's going to school and she's working. And so I'm extremely proud of her. And so again, I don't have a whole lot of experience when it comes to parenting, but I do have experience. And there are people in my church that are much more qualified to deliver this message than me. Now, here's my challenge. Some of you who are watching are single. Some of you have babies. Some of you have preschoolers. Some of you have junior high schoolers, young adults, adults. Some of you are grandparents. Some of you are great-grandparents. Some of you are foster parents. Some of you are thinking about becoming foster parents. But what we all have in common is that we all are a part of some home. And that's why I'm titling this series, Homebound. Now, the Word of God gives incredible insight when it comes to parenting. And if we want to be successful, we need to go to the manufacturer. I just brought this air fryer. I was super excited about the air fryer, looking at it on the box, and I'm like, I gotta have this thing. And I'm looking at the pictures all together assembled. When I got it home, I opened it up, and I seen that there were parts that this thing needed to be assembled. And then I took out the directions and there was a warning sign right on the directions that said, stop, read this before you use this. Now just imagine if I would have just started using that thing before I assembled it. It would not have functioned right. And so unless we assemble our lives correctly, they're not going to function right. Unless we assemble our families correctly, our families will not function right. And so what I want to do is I want to go to the origin of the family. Now, I know a lot of people who watch our broadcast don't believe in the Word of God. I just want you guys to give it a chance for today, all right? Just for today, hear it out. Let's just assume that there is a creator, and this creator left instructions for us in his Bible. The first book in the Bible is Genesis. It's called the Book of Genesis. It's the book of beginnings, and in that we see the origin of the family. And so I want to go to Genesis chapter 2. If you have your Bibles, turn to Genesis chapter 2. We're going to start at verse 20. And it says this. So the man, this is after God created man. It says, so the man gave names to all the livestock, to the birds in the sky, and all the wild animals. But for Adam, that's the man, no suitable helper was found. Verse 21. So the Lord God caused the man to fall into a deep sleep. And while he was sleeping, he took one of the man's ribs, and then he closed up the place with flesh. Then the Lord God made a woman from the rib he had taken out of the man, and he brought her to the man. And then the man said, "This is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, for she was taken out of man." Verse 24, therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. And so here in the book of Genesis, we see the first direction concerning the family. I did some research on a couple of words. The Bible says that a man shall leave his father and mother and cleave unto his wife. The Hebrew word for leave means to utterly forsake or abandon. The Hebrew word for cleave is the word dabak, and it refers to a strong bonding together of objects and often was used to represent gluing or cementing. And so this is very, very strong language. And what God is teaching us and what we learn here from the book of Genesis is that it is the job of the home to prepare children for leaving and cleaving. That in the home, the child learns to leave physically, emotionally, spiritually, financially, and relationally. Notice the order. He says, leave in verse 24, leave and cleave. That the leaving should take place before the cleaving. If you leave, if you cleave before you leave, you are asking for trouble. And that's what we see in a lot of the homes today. And a lot of the problems that we see in our society is that people are cleaving before they leave. And then he says, the two shall become one. That God's ideal is that two people would become one. One, meaning that you should be whole or you should become whole before you become one. That people are joining together and cleaving with other people and they have not become one. Simple math. One times one equals one. But if you add fractions in there and you do one half times one half, that's one fourth. And that's why we have so much drama in the home. And so we have so many challenges when it comes to using our home to prepare our children. And I want to talk about those challenges today. I'm very familiar with the challenges that we face, particularly in the inner city, but not just in the inner city, when it comes to using the home to prepare our children for life. That we have some things that we are up against. Two things that I want to name and that I want to deal with today. One is generational trauma. I had this conversation with my mentor, one of the pastors here at the church, last week. We were talking about generational trauma, that generational trauma is real. Generational trauma is trauma that's associated with things that the previous generation did or things that affected the previous generation that was passed down to the next generation. For example, there's no secret. It's not. Everybody knows that we were affected by racism. Racism is real, and it was a major problem for African Americans years ago. And that trauma affected us. And you had parents who started to split because the welfare system said that if a man was not in the home, a woman could receive money. Segregation. All of those things are generational, make up generational trauma. And then we have generational curses. And these are things that one generation did, sins of previous generations that were passed down to the next generation. And there's a passage of scripture that really speaks to both generational trauma and generational curses. It's found in Exodus chapter 20. And we're going to start at verse number 1. It said, and God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven above or on the earth beneath or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord, your God, am a jealous God. And here's the most sobering statement of the family ever written. He said, punishing the children for the sin of the parents to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me. And what this means is that God does not ignore sin. That God does not take sin lightly. That there are consequences to sin. Generational consequences. And we've seen this with our own eyes. I've watched and I've researched generations, and I watched an entire generation destroyed by alcohol. And that generation, they were having children, and they passed that curse down to their children. They were raising children in dysfunctional environments. And that next generation, a generation that my mother came up in, was a generation that was destroyed by drugs. You guys remember this, the damage that crack cocaine did in the 80s. And that generation, they were having children, and they were bringing children into the dysfunction. One curse passed down to the next generation. The next generation picking up their own curse. And then my generation, I call that the gangbanging generation. And that generation was affected because they were raised by drug addicts. And I'm not saying this is everyone, because your curses could be different from these curses, but all of us are dealing with things that were passed down to us from previous generations. And then you can throw in a few other things, even in that generation with those who were destroyed by alcohol. You had sexual abuse. You had people abusing their authority and taking advantage of children. And that carries with it its own level of dysfunction. And so dysfunction upon dysfunction upon dysfunction, generational trauma and generational curses. And that's what the Bible is talking about, that the sins of the parent is passed down from one generation to the next. He says 3 to 5 generations. And so look at the factors that affect one generation to the next. You have the DNA. That's me. I'm just like my father genetically. My son, who wasn't even around his mother much growing up, just like her in so many ways, because genetically she passed down something to him through her genes. And then the environment, that has more to do with the trauma. That there are certain challenges that we have in the African American community that many communities can't relate to. A lot of poverty, a lot of illiteracy, a lot of violence, gun violence and gang banging, a lot of things that other nationalities and races can't relate to. That's the environment. That's trauma. And as people try to move forward with their lives, they're carrying the generational curses and the generational trauma, things that they've learned from their parents. But the good news is this, that there is a way for you to improve the odds of your children succeeding in life, and you can use the home to do so. 3 key directions that God gives us from this passage of Scripture. The first is found in verse 5. He says this, he says, you shall not bow down to them or worship them, talking about these idols. For I, the Lord, your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of the parents to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me. Now, this sounds discouraging, but before you give up, follow the verse's direction. Here's what we need to do. He says, punishing the sins of the parents to the children 3 to 5 generations. If we want to improve the odds of our children succeeding, there are some things that we need to do. The first thing that we need to do, if we follow the direction of the verse, is we need to go backwards to go forward. And what that means is that we need to take a family history inventory. We need to figure out what it is that we are up against. As you research your family line, do you find that people in your family were alcoholics? Were they drug addicts? Were they addicted to porn? Was there sexual abuse? Were they lazy? Did they have commitment issues? Did they have pride issues? Did they have anger issues? We need to figure out what we're up against. Because if we can identify what we're up against, we can improve the odds for our children. Our passage today tells us the first weakness that we need to look for is found in verse number 3. He says, "You shall have no other gods before me." And so as we're doing our family inventory, as we're going backwards to go forward and looking at what we're up against, we need to ask ourselves some questions. We need to ask ourselves, what has the potential to take first place in your child's life? But an even more important question than that is you need to ask yourself, what has taken first place in your life? Because our children are watching what's important to us. What is the idol, the little god that occupies most of your time? What does everything in your life bow down to? And this is tricky because it can look good on the outside, right? That we can bow down to sports. And we can make sports an idol. We can make that our God. Some people are bowing down to their careers. Some people are bowing down to their boyfriend or their girlfriend. What is it that takes first place in your life that everything has to bow down to? Steve Jobs, former CEO of Apple, probably one of the greatest CEOs of our lifetime. In one of his dying confessions, he said, "I wrote a book so that my kids could get to know me." That's a sobering statement. Everything else bowed to Apple. And so if you want to improve your children's odds, you must identify the little god that has the potential to take first place in your child's life. You have to go backwards in order to go forward. You can't be lazy with this. You have to do a family tree inventory. Look at the history of your family. Here's number 2. You got to put God first and keep him there in your home. You have to put God first and keep him there. Now, let me show you how important this is. Verse 5, "For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of the parents to the 3rd and 4th generation of those who hate me." Now, if you put anything other than God first in your life, it affects 3 to 5 generations. But watch this. God's promises are always better than his punishments. Verse 6. But God showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. 3 to 4, 3 to 5 generations affected by idolatry, 1,000 affected by obedience. This is the greatest numerical contrast in the Bible. If you don't get anything else that I say, you have to get this. This one principle can improve your family's odds 250-1. In his book, Crisis of Morality, Al Sanders compares 2 men. The first was an atheist named Max Jukes. Max was born in the 1700s. He married a woman who slept around and dabbled in the occult. Of their 1,200 descendants, more than 600 became alcoholics. 440 died of syphilis. 310 were homeless, 90 were prostitutes, 130 went to jail, 60 were habitual thieves, 7 were murderers, and only 20 became tradesmen. 10 of them learned their trade in prison. Max and his descendants cost the state of New York over $1.3 million in incarceration costs, plus unknown costs and syphilis and other diseases. The other guy was Jonathan Edwards. He was one of the world's greatest preachers. Born in 1703, he married a woman of like character, and their descendants included 300 pastors and missionaries, 100 professors, 100 attorneys, 60 doctors, 60 authors, 30 judges, 40 university presidents, 3 state governors, 3 mayors of large cities, 1 dean of a law school, 1 dean of a medical school, 1 controller of the U.S. Treasury, and 1 vice president. Putting God first matters. And so what is the secret sauce? I can speak to this with conviction and from experience. Because I've had my share of generational trauma and generational curses. My mother was addicted to drugs. My father was addicted to alcohol. My mother was a drug addict and my father sold drugs. My mother and my father did not raise me together. In fact, they only came together to make me. They did not have a relationship. I grew up in a home where each one of my siblings had different fathers. I know what it's like to be poor. I know what it's like to go out and steal to make things happen. But God broke the curse on my family that I didn't graduate from high school, but I'm raising 3 children that are in college. The curse that was upon my family was broken. But what is the secret sauce? As the old people say, there is no secret what God can do. What he's done for others, he'll do it for you. If God did it through me, he can do it through you. We don't need to use the excuses that come our way that you can make a difference in your child's life. And I want to tell you how with this third point. You need to lead them to Christ. Understand where I'm coming from when I say this. Not shove Christ down their throat, but you need to lead them to Christ. That you need to be the example. That you need to be able to tell your children, follow me as I follow Jesus. When I see what's going on with today's parents, it breaks my heart. Using profanity to talk to your children, talking down to your children. Some parents are afraid of their children. You're not leading your children. Your children are leading you. So you need to lead them to Christ. You need to be the example. They need to see consistency between your church life and your home life. We look at the church as being the holy place and the home as being the place where I go to sleep and spend time with my family. We need to make the home holy. And that's why people are expecting the church to work miracles. You're expecting the church to work miracles in your child's life with the hour and 30 minutes that we have with your child, and they're going home to chaos. God is going to hold you accountable. And so you have to lead your child to Christ. You have to lead by example. And that's what happened to me. The curse was broken when I surrendered my life to Jesus Christ. And as a result of that, I was married for 21 years. And let me say this. I want to give Lori her props. I didn't do this thing on my own. Lori had a part to play in this. And unfortunately, our marriage ended in divorce. But we raised some beautiful children in that marriage. And both of us, we broke the curse that was upon our families. And because of that, our children are better. I surrendered to Jesus Christ. And he gave me a new opportunity. John chapter 3, verse 3 says this. Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again. That's the secret sauce, beloved. If you're watching this broadcast, that is the secret sauce. You have to surrender to Jesus and you have to lead your children to Jesus. You have to be born again. When I surrendered to Jesus, just like I had physical birth and I had to learn how to eat and I depended upon my parents to take care of me until I grew up and I could take care of myself. When you become a Christian, it's like you're born all over again and you are dependent on God to take care of you, and he will take care of you. Paul said it this way in Romans chapter 8. Verses 15 through 16. He said, the spirit you received does not make you slaves of sin. And what he's talking about is a spirit that you receive when you become a Christian. That when you become a Christian, God gives you his Holy Spirit. And he speaks to you and he lets you know whether or not what you're doing is right. And when you do the wrong thing, he will convict you and let you know that what you're doing is not right. But the spirit that you receive does not make you a slave. You're not a slave to your old way of living. He says, the spirit that you receive does not make you a slave so that you live in fear again. Rather, the spirit you received brought about your adoption to sonship. And I love this part right here. He says, and by him, talking about Jesus, because of our relationship with Jesus, by him we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. That when a baby is born and as a baby grows up, the baby's first words is mama, daddy. What Paul is teaching us is that the Hebrew children, they learn to say, Abba, which means daddy. That no matter what it is that we're going through, we can always cry out to our God, Abba. It means daddy. That we have an intimate relationship with him, that he is always there with us. And just like a father provides for his children, just like a father protects his children, just like a father leads and guides his children, when you surrender to Jesus Christ, he is your Abba, your father. And so what I want to do as I close out today's message is I want to lead you towards a relationship with Jesus, so that you can have this relationship with God as your heavenly father, your Abba, your father. The Bible teaches that God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. The Bible teaches that the wages of sin is death, that when you sin, it separates you from your God. But the gift, not something that you can pay for, not something that you can earn, the gift of God, his unmerited favor, the gift of God is eternal life, which is found in Jesus Christ. The word is near you. It's even in your mouth. It's the word of faith that we are proclaiming, that if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. And so if you're not saved, if you don't have a relationship with God as your heavenly Father, I want you to pray this prayer after me. God, I am a sinner and I need a Savior. I am making a decision today to embrace what Jesus Christ did when he died on the cross for me, as the full and final payment for all of my sins. Lord Jesus, I am asking that you would come into my heart and take control. I am surrendering to you today. In Jesus' name, amen. If you made that decision today, that is the best decision that you could have made, not only for you, but for your family and your family's family, your children and your children's children. I want to welcome you into the family of God. If you don't have a church home, we'd love for you to be a part of our family here at Peace Chapel. And to connect with us, all you have to do is just text Peace Chapel, all one word, to 31996. That's Peace Chapel, all one word, to 31996. And that'll welcome you into our network, and you'll get information, and we'll lead you on this journey that you're on. The worship team is already worshiping. I want to join them in worship. Let's worship God together. I love you, Peace Chapel. God bless you, and God keep you in his ever-loving care. Let's worship him together.
You stood before creation, eternity in your hands. You spoke it all into motion. My soul now to stand. You stood before my failure, carried the cross for my shame. My sin weighed upon your shoulders. My soul now to stand. So what can I say? What can I do? Offer this heart, oh God, completely.
Yours. I may be weak.
strong in me. My flesh may fail, my God, you never will. I may be weak, your spirit strong in me. My flesh may fail, my God, you never will. I may be weak, your spirit strong in me. My flesh may fail, my God, you never will. I may be weak, your spirit strong in me. My flesh may fail. Heart.